Hello, I'm Stewart McLaurin, President of the White House Historical Association. Welcome to this episode of the White House 1600 Sessions. Well, as you can see, we're not in Washington, D.C. today. We are in Brooklyn, New York at the Foster Reeve Plaster Studio, where they worked with a White House designer and a White House architect to design plaster elements that are actually in the White House today. The focus of the event where I am tonight is to bring together our next generation leaders of the White House Historical Association. These are young, dynamic leaders from across America in every field and sector. And tonight we're going to work with them. They're going to get their hands dirty. Emily Bedard, who is on our Next Gen Leaders Group, is actually a plaster designer here at the studio. She's going to show us how these specific elements were made for the White House, and our Next Gen leaders are going to get to participate and make some of their own and maybe even take a little piece home with them. Well, I'll also be talking with Emily, whose studio we're in tonight, with Tham Kannalikham, who is a White House designer who worked for 4 years with First Lady Melania Trump and undertook not just design of spaces in the White House, but also on very important historic preservation work in the White House. And we had an opportunity to work with her at the White House Historical Association, and now she serves on our board of directors. I'm also visiting with Steven Spandle, who is a New York-based classical architect. Steven designed the new tennis pavilion on the South Lawn of the White House, the first freestanding building on that historic property in generations. It's going to be a fun night, a fascinating conversation, so let's dive in. So I'm here to talk with one of my favorite people, and there are celebrities in life that are known by one name. There's Cher, there's Madonna, and then there's Tham. And you are, in our world, an iconic figure. One of the few people, there's an exclusive club, really, of people who have worked with First Ladies over time to help bring their vision to reality, their vision to life. And you are such an incredible designer, and you have a wonderful career that has been yours and very special and low-key. How in the world did you get on the radar of a First Lady of the United States?
Through word of mouth, through clients who spoke highly of me, of my work, and also because the study programs that I've done in the past 20 years, going to Paris, going to London, to Ireland, so many summer schools to study about architecture, landscape, decorative arts, interiors, that has evolved and has come to America. The history from European history, architecture, to here.
Do you remember when you first became interested in this type of work?
I could remember from a very young age, probably 8, just going to grocery stores while my mother did the shopping. My brothers and sisters, you know, we would go to the grocery store and sit in the magazine aisle and look at magazines. My brothers and sisters would probably look at Teen Pop, and there's me sitting there with Architectural Digest. We came from humble beginning. I was always a big, big dreamer, and it was my dream to have a beautiful home, a big house, beautiful yard for my family. And it just spoke to me because it was the American dream.
Wow. Tell me what kind of training or experience you have in the early part of your career, and how does your career evolve to being the prominent designer that you are today?
It was through a client that had a home in North Carolina. It's with him that he pushed me to study American history and really travel the world to bring back his family legacy, the American architecture and its history. And so for many years, he allowed me to travel through America and also through Europe. That's so important to building a legacy home.
So he was an inspiration to you to better understand the history of architecture in our country?
Yes.
Wow. Did you ever visit the White House as a student or a young girl before this project?
No. It was actually at an older age that I was able to visit the White House. I still remember the day, the year. It was September 7th, 2001. A few days before that tragic of 9/11, we were able to visit the White House. I was looking, you know, from the gate, not able to be inside. Mm-hmm. And I just thought how wonderful the interior must be, how magical it would be. 20 years later, I visited the White House, entered the White House, not as a visitor, but the appointed decorator to the first family. And every time I walk in the house, it's beyond magic. And it really is such a place that means so much to me and my family. Mm. It's a sense of hope, opportunity, and all things great about America.
Wow, that is so inspirational. And we're here at this wonderful studio, and Elamelie Bedard, who is on our Next Generation Leaders Group, mm-hmm. is hosting us here tonight and works in this amazing plaster studio, creating these elements. Tell us a little bit about how you work with artists and artisans like Emily, and how do you find these people who have these unique skills and crafts that feed into your design and vision and the First Lady's design and vision?
So for me, it's always been about understanding the process of great craftsmanship. And so I really wanted to celebrate in all my projects, I wanted to incorporate great American craftsmanship. And so through going to lectures, being in clubs and foundations and institutions of the same ilk, we are able to kind of connect and refer each other. And for me, it was very important to understand process. So then it's just not about moldings. It's about the people who's doing it. I would frequent a lot of the people who do craftsmen, flooring, you name it. I was there to learn about the process because I really feel great craftsmanship is the backbone of great design.
Mm. Your work is now a part of White House history. How does that make you feel?
I still pinch myself is because it's an opportunity that I never thought I would have. I am a dreamer, and so I never thought I would dream this big. But only I feel like for me in America, I can come immigrate from Laos to America and become the appointed decorator for the First
Lady.
Wow,
what a great country, huh?
It is. It's really a wonderful country. And I do, like, I don't take for granted the people like you and the American people. And having the opportunity to live here is, and for my family, is really incredible.
I think one of the most compelling parts of your story is that most people would expect that you would have known Mrs. Trump or President Trump in their life in New York, but you didn't. They sought you out because of your, as you said, word of mouth. And so you hear from them and you think, what, is this for real?
So I actually got a phone call from them and then an email to meet with the, at that time, the future First Lady. Mm-hmm. And at that time, it was a 30-minute interview or meet. It turned out to be a 3-hour meet just because it just felt so natural. We talked about architecture. We talked about American history. We talked about, you know, the history of fabric. And we also talked about, like, just goals and understanding that we were both immigrants.
Oh, that's incredible, yes.
Yeah, so, and with all my projects being very private, I could not show any photos. And so I just showed her the sketches of furniture that I designed, trim, postamentary, and everything was just, I couldn't really show her photos of my projects. And I think from that moment, after our conversation, she felt my commitment to making sure that I saw her vision, but also she knew that I was going to be very respectful to the house, mm-hmm. and incorporating just a strong design for them because it wasn't about their design. It was about the respect, the design of the president's house.
Well, in addition to creating new components of White House interiors and the tennis pavilion, there was also work to take care of the house and preservation of interiors that were already there. Tell us a bit about that.
When I went in, I definitely had the same ethos of the White House Historic Association is to preserve and protect. So my goal was just not to decorate, but also to be able to be part of conservation, preservation of the house. And so when I saw the needs of, you know, to do conservation and restoration of the doors, you know, for the French polish, doing the accurate method of French polish for the doors. First family comes in and there's a short span that gets turned over to redecorate for the incoming first family. And so some of these things are not to say neglected, but there's not time for us to do, you know, for the house to do it properly. Or it'll be where, you know, you put it into a process of maybe in a few years. So for me, I really thought it was important to restore the doors, the flooring, the handrails of, you know, people, things that people just don't really, it's not glamorous, but I think it's important to do.
Wow, and I really commend you for that because part of our role, as you know, is to protect and preserve this house from not just president to president, but from generation to generation. If someone were to come to you and be interested in a career like yours, what's the best advice you would give them?
I would tell them to travel. Travel as much as you can. If travel, you know, is an opportunity that you can do every year, you should do it because there is such a big difference to seeing things in, you know, in textbook or magazines. It's the visual and the connection that you'll get from travel and the scale and proportion that you will understand in person.
I hear you use those words, scale and proportion, quite a bit. It's sort of your mantra. Tell me what that is to you.
If you have good scale and proportion and you have great foundation architecturally, then it's easier for designers to really put their decorative elements to it. It's visual. And with that visual, it's a lot of hard work of reading, research, and traveling. So your eyes are trained to see great scale and proportion.
Years from now, when you reflect back on your time at the White House, what will be your favorite memories?
There's actually a lot of favorite memories for me is because the moment I stepped into the first day of the White House, I took on this moment, this proud moment for my family and myself, that hard work and opportunity really does happen in America. And then there's so many other opportunities where I don't even know how to pinpoint one because there's just so many great opportunities and memories that I have. You know, it's just being there is all really amazing to me.
Well, I want to thank you for what you did in working with Mrs. Trump and the privilege that we had to work together then and continue that work with you on our board of directors, and just so admire and appreciate the skill and the vision, the talent, and just the wonderfulness that you bring to whatever you do, but particularly to the role of the White House. So thank you, Tham.
Thank you.
So we're here in Brooklyn, New York, in the famous plaster architecture studio of Foster Reeve. Now, they've done work on amazing places around the country, but they've actually done work on the White House. And part of that collaborative team is Steven Spandle, who is a New York-based architect, and he actually designed the new tennis pavilion on the grounds of the White House, the first building that's been built on the White House ground in generations. So, Steven, it's great to be with you. Let's talk first a little bit about you and your interest in architecture. How did you first become interested in architecture and then in the classical bent with architecture?
I grew up in South Georgia in a small town named Claxton, about 45 minutes inland from Savannah. And pretty much as far back as I can remember, I've always been interested in architecture. always wanted to go see historic houses. My parents were wonderful about that and indulgent. We went to Savannah, to the historic district, a fair amount when I was younger, toured the historic houses there that are open to the public. Every year we would go to Jekyll Island for a conference and, of course, go tour the cottages there, which are amazing, amazing buildings with people like David Adler and John Russell Pope. So I was exposed to these things at an early age and was incredibly lucky that that happened. And I was always passionate about traditional architecture in particular. I was, I guess, one of the lucky few that knew from an early age what their passion was. Went to Georgia Tech for undergrad, a modern program, contemporary program. So I've seen both sides of the coin. Trained there, was lucky to have a wonderful architecture history professor that pointed me toward Notre Dame for graduate school and went there for their classical program after I finished at Georgia Tech.
Did you visit the White House as a young boy or as a student?
I did in fifth grade.
Oh, I did too. That's great.
So my mother actually started a tradition with my older brother where in fifth grade, she took him, just the two of them, to D.C., and they did a full D.C. tour. And so when I came of age, I was in fifth grade, we did the same tour again. So we went to the Capitol building, went to the White House, went to the Smithsonian, toured all the monuments, went to Mount Vernon.
Yeah, sure.
And then, of course, I, being a history buff, had seen Tudor Place somewhere on TV as a child and said, I'd really love to go to Tudor Place. So we made the hike out to Tudor Place, toured that. So it was an amazing experience.
And hanging on the wall of my office in Washington is a picture of my fifth grade class trip to Washington. And
sure.
Little tyke sitting on the lawn of the Capitol, and very vivid memories of the Capitol and the White House, Arlington, Mount Vernon, just as you've described.
Yes.
And I don't know if that led to what I'm doing today, but I think it planted seeds of interest in history and these buildings that contain the institutions of American history. Were you more awed by the White House then or when you had the opportunity to visit as an architect?
It's interesting. I was definitely influenced by things when I was in fifth grade. I remember, in particular, for some reason, I remember being fascinated by the courtyards of the Supreme Court building and doing plan sketches after the DC trip, focused on that in particular. I would say visiting the White House as an adult working there, definitely extremely different from going when I was younger. When I was younger, I was just absorbing everything that I was around, especially growing up on a farm. Anytime I was somewhere that had buildings, that had classical architecture, I was absorbing it. Going as an adult and having the opportunity to work there was amazing. When I first went, when Tham was tasked by the First Lady, by the former First Lady, to be the interior designer for the administration, and we went to the house for the first time, we, of course, had no idea what we would be doing there. I had no clue that I would have the opportunity to design a building for the grounds, which just surpassed anything I could have ever imagined.
Yeah, you and James Hoban have that.
Right. So just, yeah, going and being able to spend time in the house. There were many days when Tham would be upstairs still in meetings with the First Lady. I would have already finished with my part of the meetings, and I was able to just spend time in the staterooms alone in the evening as the sun is setting outside.
That's very
just
special.
Walking through the rooms, and was able to spend hours there just looking and absorbing and looking at the decorative arts and the collection and the details, the paintings. Amazing experience. And some of my favorite memories from being there really was that alone time that I was able to have in the house. Just
that's very special. Most people, when they're on a tour with their family,
yes,
are just looking, it's just so much stimulation.
Right.
But to have the opportunity to absorb it and feel that history that you're a part of with those who have been in those spaces throughout history is really amazing. Well, tonight we have the opportunity to visit with about 30 young people who are part of our Next Gen Leaders program. Some of them may be interested in architecture or design. What would you say to someone interested in following your footsteps? And they came to you and say, Stephen, I'd like to design a building on the White House grounds one day. What's the best path?
So I would say go and see as much as possible. I was fortunate to be able to do a study abroad program in undergrad and in graduate school. So I was able to live in Paris for two semesters, live in Rome for a semester. Mm. But really, the thing that I think was most formative in my younger years especially was going to visit historic buildings, going to house museums, going to just your average houses, just historic houses on a farm somewhere. Anything I could get into, I was always eager to go and see. And also building a great reference library. That's something I learned from my very first boss right out of undergraduate, a man, Norman Askins, an architect in Atlanta. And Norman imparted upon me how important a great reference library is. I was already passionate about books, so didn't take much of a twist of my arm to get me to really delve into collecting. And I started really building a great library at that point. And that's imperative, I think, especially if you're going to go into the field of traditional or classical design. A great reference library is incredibly important, incredibly important.
Reflecting back on your time there, which probably seems like a blur now in hindsight, what are your favorite memories of that experience?
Let's see, probably my favorite memories were at the very end of the tennis pavilion project when construction had wrapped up. My mother really wanted to come up and see the building. So my parents, my brother and sister-in-law, and my nieces came up, met myself and my husband, Kev, in DC, and we did a tour of the house. And then the usher's office took us down to the pavilion and just left us there for a few hours.
Nice.
Which was really very, very special. Amazing memory. Really thrilled I was able to have the opportunity to do that. Definitely incredibly meaningful to my parents. And then also one of the last construction visits to the tennis pavilion. While construction was almost wrapped up, but not quite there, on a Saturday I drove down with my husband, Kev. We went, did a site visit, and then we were leaving and walking back from the tennis pavilion up towards the house. The sprinklers were on, it was a beautiful sunny day, and he looked at me and said, "Remember this moment." And I do. And that's one of my favorite memories, and I always will. It's just a beautiful afternoon on the White House grounds, walking in the sunshine back toward the house. And then we went back in and did a loop through the staterooms before we left, alone, just the two of us.
That's a great story.
Very special.
And wise advice to savor the moment
right
while you're there.
Right.
Well, thank you for sharing your experiences with us, and congratulations on achieving such an amazing project of a lifetime, project of a career. But I'm sure you have many wonderful things ahead of you. So
thank you.
Thanks for your time today, Stephen. Well, here we are in the Foster Reeve studio. And Emily, this is your home. Emily Bedard is on our Next Gen Leadership group and has invited us here to this incredible studio in Brooklyn, New York. And you're in here every day creating and making. And I can't wait to hear, how in the world did you get into this as a career?
I always knew I wanted to go into the arts. However, it's sculpture that really drew me in because of the opportunity for collaboration.
And how'd you get started with sculpture?
Well,
what are the first steps?
When I was in high school, and earlier than that, I knew I wanted to be an artist, and I was very fortunate to have parents who encouraged that creativity. My father was a builder, and my mother was a public school teacher, and they both really fostered my creativity. And I decided that if I'm going to go into the arts, then I want to study traditional art, because I want to come out of school with a set of really strong skills. So I decided to go to a traditional art school that only taught classical sculpture, painting, and drawing.
Okay. So you study this and you're in school, and then, okay, how do I make a career out of this? How does that happen?
When I went to school, so I thought first I was going to study painting. And the school that I went to has a wonderful painting department. However, the sculpture department really started to lure me in, because you have to learn human anatomy for figurative sculpture. You have to learn mold making and carpentry and casting. And suddenly you're learning all these different skills that can be applied to other trades. So I thought, I'm going to pursue that, because it's going to give me more options when I go to pursue a career. And I remember in college when we were sophomores, we were asked to declare whether we were going to be a sculpture major or a painting major.
Yes, okay.
And the sculpture department sat us down. They had a panel of the sculpture department heads at the front of the room. And there was one sculptor who said, an adjunct teacher, who the majority of his work was public commissions. Mm. And he said, I get so much work through public commissions that I rarely have the time to do my own creative work. And doing these public commissions gives me the opportunity to collaborate with engineers and architects. And that just...
Wow, the light bulb went off.
Yeah, the light bulb went off. Because I always thought about entering engineering or architecture because I have a very technical mind as well. So I just thought, here's this wonderful field where I can employ... my artistic abilities and my technical abilities and interest in building
and collaboration. And all of a sudden, you have the opportunity to work and do this at the White House. Tell me about the creative chemistry with Steven as an architect and Tham as a designer and doing what you do. What's that like? How does it work?
Sure, absolutely. I work here with Foster Reeve. So Foster Reeve is the founder of this business, and he's developed these relationships with architects and designers over the years. So he has been able to bring in these very high profile projects. And he and Tham and Steven have been working together for a very long time. And we have done several projects together, notably her project in North Carolina. And we just developed a really nice rapport. I'm always excited when she comes to the studio to work. And then one day Foster came to me and said, oh, Emily, you're going to be working on the White House. Tham and Steven got this project to do the tennis pavilion, and they're going to be coming by, and we're going to review.
And had you ever been to the White House before?
Yes. I had gone like on a family trip when I was in elementary school. I remember taking like the regular public tour.
Never dreaming one day you would be back.
Yeah.
Creating something
exactly
that would be in this space for generations to come.
I have a fascination with civic work. I'm always looking for a chance to do work that's going to give back to the country in some way. And being able to do something in the White House is just a great indicator to me that
let me tell you something I think you will appreciate.
Okay.
To have a painting in the White House collection, the artist, according to the collection policy, must be deceased and the work of art 25 years old or older. So you are a living young artist and your work is there in the White House. That is pretty amazing.
I never thought of it that way. Yes, that is amazing. And like I always think of a building as a living thing. Mm-hmm. And when I'm able to contribute a piece of art or contribute to the architecture of the space, mm-hmm. it feels like you're really putting your life into it and that it's gonna keep living through you. And when I do a project with the company, there's so many hands in it. Mm-hmm. Like I may have helped with the design, but I also have a team of artisans who are helping me build these mm-hmm. things. And so when I look at projects that I've done, I see all those people in it as well.
So you made the right choice of going sculpture versus painting.
Yes, absolutely.
So a young person comes to you and says, Emily, I'm going to do what you do. What would you tell them?
I would tell them, come work with me. Well, really, I mean, there's so few people who decide to go into this line of work, perhaps because people have been telling them not to go into the arts. This field of work, there's plenty of opportunity in it. And if you come with a sense of discipline and a desire to make excellent work and a desire to learn and push yourself to develop those skills, then you can absolutely be successful in this field.
I'm here. I'm not a next gen leader, but I want to be you when I grow up. So this is fun.
Well, thank you. I'm always excited to have people come and visit and gain a deeper understanding for what goes into producing this kind of work. And when you get to participate in the process, like we will tonight in the demonstrations, you gain a sense of ownership for it. Mm-hmm. And then when you go to visit the White House, you're going to see those elements and you're going to say, I know how that was made.
So Emily, I have a couple of fun things here. These are actually elements of your work that are in the White House complex today in the tennis pavilion. Tell us about this one.
Sure. So this is called a Greek key, and that is repeated in a module fashion, and it's a frieze that goes around the top of the wall, mm-hmm. around the entire room. Mm-hmm. And it has this laurel branch that weaves through the key. We'll first create a pattern or a model, and that's a combination of hard material and sculpted clay. Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, we'll pour rubber, which will make a rubber flexible mold. And then when that rubber is cured, it's pulled off, and then we pour plaster into it. And that creates what we have here now.
And so this is actually what would be mounted around the top of the room. And then it is painted?
Yes.
And tell us about what you're holding.
Sure. This is a rosette. This is one of three rosettes that are in these little coffers within an archway inside of the tennis pavilion.
And does this have a design or a certain flower
that
it represents?
Yes, this is an acanthus rosette. Each of these little leaves is an acanthus, and sometimes this little leaf here is called a tongue.
Well, thank you for sharing these samples with
You're
us.
You're very welcome.
It's
We're
really
going to
cool.
make some tonight.
Thank you so much for sharing your story with us.
You're welcome, Stewart. Thank you so much for being here
My
tonight.
Pleasure. So next we're going to see an actual plaster demonstration by our own next-gen leader, Emily Bedard.
So on this table, we can see some drawings of plaster rosettes. Those are all done by hand. I don't use Photoshop much. Microsoft Paint is my favorite. But up here in this studio, this is where we do all of the artistic elements, which is often a combination of plaster, resin, and sculpting of clay. This oil-based clay, it always stays soft, kneaded around, and we use sculpting tools to make these fine details. And then once that is finished, we make this rubber mold. It's solid now, but it begins in a liquid state. So what we do when we finish a model, here I have some plaster models of those rosettes, we make a little wall around it with clay, and then we mix rubber, which comes in a two-part material that's mixed together and it's liquid, and you pour it onto the rosettes. And that sits overnight, and then you peel it off and you get this rubber mold, which is a flexible piece of rubber that you then pour liquid plaster into. And then after it sets for about 20 minutes, you pop it right out of the mold. And that's what we're all gonna do tonight. So I'm gonna cast this bracket right here. And you gotta kind of estimate how much plaster you're gonna use. We have these three different sizes. The larger molds are gonna use a bigger amount. You each have a water bucket at your table. I'm just gonna scoop. So you're gonna sift the plaster into the water and just slowly let it absorb. It's gonna get to a point where it forms like a little island on top. You see that? It's just like, it can't take anymore. So at that point, you're gonna take a whisk or one of these sticks and just start to mix it up. It feels a lot like baking. And one way to test whether the plaster is thick enough, just take your hand and dip it in. And if it coats your hand nicely like that, then it's thick enough. So now I have my mold, and it's totally dry. So before I pour the plaster in, just get a nice mist and just kind of spray over the mold. So it just kind of makes it all a little bit wet. And that just helps the plaster get into all the detail and eliminates air bubbles. So now I'm going to take my wet plaster and just start to pour it into the mold like so. I'm not going to pour it all the way full, about a third of the way, and then just pick up your mold and move it around. I'm going to drop it on the table, vibrate it a little bit. Helps release any air bubbles that get stuck into the detail. And then just fill it up the rest of the way.
And you'll want to let it fill kind of just above the surface. Because as it sets, which will be about 15 minutes, it'll start to get thicker. And then we'll come back with a spatula and scrape off the excess. But you have to wait for it to get a little bit thick. And then after 20 minutes, we'll be able to pop it out of the mold.
So while we're here tonight, and they're trying their hand at plaster design, I put a few of our next-gen leaders on the spot.
Okay, Emily, how are they doing? Let's talk about, tell me how Royce is doing here.
Royce is operating with very good precision. So he's made a perfect mix of plaster, and now he's slowly drizzling that plaster into the mold.
And what is this one that he's about to
put on? This one here, that is 1/4 of a rosette. So this one is funny. It kind of looks like a bat. And he's doing very well.
What's this like?
It's incredible. It's relaxing. Never done it before. I feel like I could do it all day.
Okay, Pendleton, tell us what you've done.
Okay, I have chosen the smallest and flattest of the molds.
Why is that?
Apparently those are almost guaranteed to come out in one piece. So I'm very excited.
And these are rosettes, I think.
Different yes.
Rosettes were used in the White House.
Yes, exactly.
Excellent. So you mixed up the plaster.
Yes.
Poured it in.
Yes.
Got the bubbles out.
Yes.
So kind of the cakes
these,
in the
these
oven.
These were pretty, exactly. And I actually am a pretty good baker. At the
oh, there you go. Well, we'll see. Yeah. Proof will be in the pudding.
Hopefully the skills translate.
That's great. Okay, Jonathan, tell us what you've done here.
So mine is sort of a floral shape. And we've been doing this plaster work. We've learned how to make the plaster. We put it in here. We kind of sprayed it down so it'll come out, and now it's drying. Mm-hmm. And then we're going to scrape the top here in a little bit, I think. And then we'll flip it over, and we'll have sort of a rosette of some sort.
So have you ever done anything like this in the Navy?
No. We don't build ships out of plaster. They're out of steel, I guarantee you. Yeah, that's great.
So fun process?
Oh, absolutely. So involved and so creative. Absolutely.
Yeah, right. Thank you. Enjoyed it.
So plaster has a life cycle. It's about 20 minutes. From the time you mix it, it stays liquid for about 10 minutes, and then it starts to get thicker. And once it gets to a point where you can push it and it stays where it is, we take a spatula like this, and we go over our mold, and we strike it off, it's called. So, and that just makes the back of your casting level with the surface, the top surface of the mold. So we're gonna strike these all off, go sit down for dinner, and when dinner's complete, we'll come back out and pop them out of the mold.
First of all, I wanna thank Emily for being our hostess with the mostest tonight. Thank you so much. So, and Tham and Steven, you've met and heard a little bit about what they have done, but we're going to unpack that story a little bit more. But let's talk about the White House in that vein, that it is not a static thing. This is a living home, and it changes and evolves. And so John and Abigail Adams move in November of 1800, and here we are in the summer of 2022, and it's evolved so much over that time. Tham, as you were doing what you were doing, and Stephen and Emily, how wedded are you to the traditions of the place and the what has gone before you? How much are you at liberty to change and to reinterpret these spaces?
There is a process, and I think everyone think that there isn't a process. All first families can do anything, but definitely there's a process. For me, going into it, we really thought that the design and the first lady also, it's very important to keep the design direction and respect to the respect of the architecture of the house and the first family that came before them. And so for us, it was a design that has to represent strength, history, legacy, and the preservation of what's already there. Mm-hmm. So we took that into account when we did the design.
So let's talk about that, the process. So there's no law that says the blue room has to be blue, but custom and tradition prevail there. Mm-hmm. And thanks to Mrs. Kennedy, we have these systems and checks and balances. We have a curator, we have the White House Historical Association, we have the but is now the Committee for the Preservation of the White House, a volunteer advisory group, all very different than when you have a private client. So, Stephen, how did you find building a building, having to go through all of those hoops?
So, when we were tasked with the responsibility of upgrading the facilities at the tennis court, essentially what we initially thought and what immediately came to mind, and as being a classical architect and a traditionalist, is really doing something that would fit into the ground seamlessly. So we looked back at the existing buildings. We looked at the east wing, the west wing. We obviously didn't want to build a little White House, but we wanted to do something that looked like it was in keeping with the ancillary buildings on the property, specifically with the east and west wing.
But it was really an important design, is because it's the only private outdoor space for the first family. So we had to take into account like their privacy, right, and making sure that it is comfortable. But and so that had to come into play.
An interesting thing you learn when you work at the White House is that really any outdoor space at the White House, the first family is on view. They're on display. They're in the public eye. The tennis court's very special because it does have a large landscape sort of hedge around it. It's one of the very few places where you can be outdoors and people can't see you. The swimming pool, you would never want to go to. The entire executive office building overlooks it, so you definitely don't want to sunbathe there. But we really wanted to give the first family and future first families a place where they could go, just get some fresh air, spend an afternoon, possibly even pull up a grill and barbecue.
And these things really do convey from family to family. It's not viewed, or it's not called the Trump Tennis Pavilion.
Right. No.
The Bidens spend a lot of time there. You may have seen recently Naomi Biden, the president's granddaughter, is getting married at the White House this fall, tweeted a picture from the tennis pavilion, and they will all gather there. So these things do shift from presidency to presidency and to become a part of the fabric of family, of life there. So it really is a space. And it doesn't, the mm-hmm. way that you've crafted it, it looks like it's always been there and been a part of the White House, which is really incredible.
Thank you. At the very beginning, it was exciting. The day of the inauguration was the first time we entered the house. We had no idea what we would be doing. So never crossed my mind that we would have the opportunity to design a building from scratch to go on the White House grounds. That was beyond my wildest dreams, really. You would never expect that to happen. But it was absolutely amazing, but we sort of hurried through on the first day, and really when we left, it was kind of, I think we left thinking, what just happened? what was that? We just ran through the White House. We went through the whole residence, and then we were back outside again thinking, wow, like, we're here. What's going on? It was amazing and sort of scary a little bit. But also at the same time, made me think of my family, my grandfather in particular, who at that point was in his 90s and still with us, and thinking like he would be so amazed, someone who grew up on a farm, lived on the farm his entire life, right next door to the farm I grew up on, that his grandson was at the White House and working there.
I want to thank you all for coming tonight. This has been inspirational to me. Thank you, Emily, for hosting our very first event of this group. And thank you to Tham and Stephen for sharing your career and insights. You really do have unique perspective on how this house is what it is and how it's maintained. Well, I think it's time for us to go see your projects and products of your handiwork.
Beautiful. It's Christmas morning out here. Just remember, the mold is flexible, the past is not. Beautiful.
Well, that was a fascinating time here in Brooklyn, New York, learning how these plaster design elements are made and participating with our next gen leaders in trying their hand at this wonderful craft. I want to thank Emily Bedard in the Foster Reeve Studio, Tham Kannalikham and Steve Spandle for being our guests tonight, And thank you for joining us. It's my honor and privilege to tell these stories of the White House and its history through the White House 1600 Sessions. For more information on our work and to learn about all aspects of White House history, and actually, if you'd like to support our work, we would greatly appreciate that as well. Visit our website, whitehousehistory.org.